بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our 11th lesson going through the book Mukhtasar Sagheer, authored by Sheikh Bafadl رحمه الله تعالى. We stopped at the statement of the author رحمه الله فصلٌ فروض الصلاة 17. We mentioned that the integral acts of the prayer are 17 when you order it the way that the author رحمه الله ordered it. But in reality, you can combine with some of the pillars that the author rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned into just one pillar, and that's the pillar of al-tumanina. And so the actual number of integral acts for the prayer is essentially 13 and not really 17. Although some ulama mentioned 17, some mentioned 15, and that's all. This is relative due to the amount of tumanina that you mentioned, whether you mention it with tafsir or you mention it ijmalan. طيب. We mentioned that we can categorize the integral acts of the prayer into three. The first, al-rukn al-arkan al-qawliya, wal-arkan al-fi'liya, wa al-rukn al-qalbi. And the author rahimahullah begins with the rukn al-qalbi, which is an-niyyah. Wal-niyyatu qasdu shay'in muqtarinan bifi'lihi. It is to intend to do something simultaneously doing that thing, right? Wa mahalluha al-qalb wa talaffuzu biha sunnatun 'inda ash-Shafi'iyyah. And we mentioned this previously. And so, when it comes to the intention, it is something that is required in order for you to have a valid prayer. And the intention falls under the arkan. And so it's the rukn al-qalbi. If the salah, and remember we mentioned that the salawat can be of two types, either an obligatory prayer or a supererogatory prayer. If it's an obligatory prayer, then you have to intend three things. The first thing, qasdu fi'liha. You have to intend performing this action of the salah. وَتَعْيِينِهَا You also have to specify which obligatory prayer you are performing. Is it Dhuhr? Is it Asr? Is it Maghrib? Is it Isha? Is it Fajr? You have to specify which it is. And likewise, وَنِيَّةُ الْفَرْضِيَّةِ مِنَ الْبَالِغِ And if you are a person who is responsible, if you are a person who is accountable, like you've passed the age of puberty, then you also need to intend that this salah is an obligatory prayer. And so if a person is praying an obligatory prayer, the intention must comprise three things. Number one, the fact that you are intending to perform this salah. Number two, what type of salah is it? Is it Dhuhr? Is it Asr? Is it Maghrib? Is it Isha? Is it Fajr? And that this intent and that this salah is an obligatory salah. If you come with these three, then that is sufficient. Other people might come with extra intentions, like مثلاً how many rak'at, 4 rak'at, is it for Allah لله تعالى, and so on. You find people say, طيب, أصلي صلاة الظهر 4 rak'at. لله تعالى, and it's of course فرض. That's what some people might say. However, if you suffice yourself with the three points that the author رحمه الله تعالى mentioned, قصد الفعل والتعيين ونية الفرضية من البالغ, who's the one who is accountable, then you have come with the required intention for the صلاة الفرضية. Remember we said that the صلاة is of two types, فرض النفل, and the نفل further divides into two, نفل مطلق and نفل مقيد, right? And so the author رحمه الله said, وَإِنْ كَانَتْ نَافِلَةً مُؤَقَّتَةً كَالْوِتْرِ أَوْ ذَاتَ سَابَابٍ كَالْكُسُوفِ وَجَبَ قَصْدُ فِعْلِهَا وَتَعَيِّنُهَا وَإِنْ كَانَتْ نَافِلَةً مُطْلَقَةً وَجَبَ قَصْدُ فِعْلِهَا فَقَطْ If the supererogatory prayer that you are performing is a normal supererogatory prayer, you're just praying two raka'at for Allah Azza wa Jal, then all you need to come is with the intention of performing that salah. That's it. You only need to come with the intention of performing the salah. That's all you need to come with. However, if the supererogatory prayer that you are praying is a nafilah that is has a specified time in which you are supposed to perform that nafilah, مثلاً salat al-duha or salat al-witr, مثلاً, then you need to come with two parts to your intention. The first part is قصد الفعل, the intention of performing this salah, and التعيين. You have to also specify that this salah is what salat al-witr or salat al-duha and so on. And likewise, if the salat, the supererogatory prayer, is a salat that sabab, like salat al-kusuf or al-khusuf and so on, or مثلاً salat tahiyyat al-masjid and so on. You have to specify this salah as being a whatever salah it is. So the intention has to carry two points. The first point is niyatu qasd al-fi'l, wa aydan ta'yin al-salah. And so that is the summary of the mabahith pertaining to the niyyah that the author rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned. And then now we move on to the second pillar that the author rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned. And this pillar is a pillar which is qawliya. So put it under the category of al-arkan al-qawliya, which is takbiratul ihram. Takbiratul ihram. And takbiratul ihram is to say, as the author rahimahullah mentioned, wa hiya an yaqul, wa hiya an taqul, Allahu akbar. Allah is the most great, or Allah is the greatest.
ويجزئه, and it is also sufficient for a person to say Allahul Akbar. And according to the author Rahimullah, in order for you to say, or for you to say Allahul Akbar is also sufficient. And so that is the opinion of the author Rahimahullah Ta'ala. However, stay away from the khilaf, and khurujan min al-khilaf, say Allahu Akbar. Don't add anything to it. And remember, we mentioned Safinat al-Najah, this issue, right? We said we don't add to the takbirat al-ihram. We just keep it as it is. Allahu Akbar. Then the author Rahimahullah, he said, وَيَجِبُ أَن تَكُونَ هَذِهِ النِّيَّةُ مُقَارَنَةً لِلتَّكْبِيرِ جَمِعِهِ. And this is a view that the author Rahimahullah Ta'ala holds, which is, of course, khilafan lil-mu'tamad عند النووي والغزالي وابن عالي الجويني مثلا. طيب, these ulama, they differed with the author on this issue. ويجب أن تكون هذه النية مقارنة للتكبير جميعه. الشيخ بافضل رحمه الله, he mentions that it is obligatory that the intention, when you're coming with the intention, it must be alongside the takbir, however long the takbir takes. So throughout the takbir, you need to have this intention, i.e. this intention must follow the takbir simultaneously. And so you find some people, they perform the intention before the takbir, or they perform the intention after the takbir. No, according to the author rahimahullah, he says that you have to do it with the takbir. However, what is mu'tamad fil madhab is that if the person is standing to perform the prayer and he's just about to start, it doesn't matter. Likewise, as long as it's come with the intention, when it's Allahu Akbar, it doesn't have to what? Come with it. It doesn't have to be a continuous intention throughout the what? Throughout the takbir. I.e. مثلا, whilst you're saying Allahu Akbar, you're mentioning قصد الفعل وتعيين ونية الفرضية. طيب, you don't do that. As according to the mu'tamad. However, the mu'tamad says, bring it just before you enter into the takbirat al-ihram, or just as you start the takbirat al-ihram, when you finish, you finish. طيب, with a niyyah. And so that is the يعني خلاف ميسر في هذه المسألة. And I said, as I mentioned earlier, and in other classes, the niyyah is not something which is quite difficult. You shouldn't make it more difficult than it is. People make the niyyah more arduous and more difficult and more complex than it really is. The fact that you're getting up to perform the salah, the fact that you're getting up to perform the wudu, the fact that you're getting up to perform the act of worship, that's the intention already. You have already come with the intention. And so don't make the intention something what? More bigger than it actually is. طيب, the author rahimahullah then said, الثالث. So now we've spoken about takbirat al-ihram, وهي ركنون. This takbirat al-ihram is a rukn. Any other takbir throughout the salah is not a rukn. But this takbirat al-ihram is a rukn. And so the one who doesn't come with takbirat al-ihram, then his salah is what? Is invalid. His salah is invalid. And of course, you raise your hands up to what? Up to the shoulders, or in between the shoulders and the earlobes. طيب. Then the author rahimahullah, he said, الثالث, القيام إن كانت الصلاة فرضا وقدرا. طيب. The third pillar, put it under أركان الفعلية, which is القيام, to stand. So you have to stand upright. If the salat is an obligatory prayer. So the salat must be an obligatory prayer for al-qiyam to be considered a rukn. Likewise, if you have the ability to stand, then the standing becomes a rukn in your case. So for you to be able to put qiyam under al-rukn al-fi'li, you need to come with two things. Number one, the salat that you're performing must be an obligatory prayer. And number two, you must be able to stand. فَالَّذِي لَا يَقْدِرُ عَلَى الْقِيَامِ, the one who's unable to stand. And of course, who determines whether you're unable to stand? A tabib, a doctor who is a Muslim and is trustworthy. Muslimun thiqah, a Muslim and a responsible thiqah, a trustworthy individual, a trustworthy qualified doctor. He is the one who's able to determine whether you are able to stand up or not. And so, إِذَا قَدَرْتَ عَلَى الْقِيَامِ وَكَانَتِ الصَّلَاةُ صَلَاةً فَرْضِيَّةً وَجَبَ عَلِكَ بَلْ هُوَ رُكْنٌ مِنْ أَرْكَانِ الصَّلَاةِ. مسألة القيام. القيام is a ركن من أركان الصلاة, for the one who is able to stand, and the salat that he's performing is a fard prayer. If the salat that he's performing is a nafil prayer, then the qiyam is not a ركن. Rather, he can pray sitting down. There is no problem. طيب. If he's unable to stand, then the qiyam is what? Is not a ركن upon him. طيب. So that's the third pillar. The fourth pillar is قراءة الفاتحة. You have to recite سورة الفاتحة. And that's the first chapter of the Quran. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. آية منها. And the basmala is of course a verse from Surah Al-Fatiha. And so you begin with the basmala and you end at Waladdallin. And the author Rahimahullah then mentions certain etiquettes that you have to abide by, certain points that you have to abide by when reciting the Fatiha. Number one, يجب ترتيبها. You have to recite it in the order it has come. And so you can't start with مالك يوم الدين then follow it up with الرحمن الرحيم then إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. No, it has to be in order. From بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. This is what you have to come with. Likewise, وموالاتها. The ayat you recite, it must be done in a consecutive manner. The ayat that you are reciting, it must be in a consecutive manner. So you must not cut off halfway through the recitation. So you don't say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen and then you just stand around keeping silent and so on. لا. You have to recite it in a consecutive manner. Likewise, وتشديداتها. You have to also, every letter that has a shadda on it, Surah Al-Fatiha, you have to give it its right. So you have to give every single letter its حقوق, its right. And so when you say Alhamdulillahi, that shadda here, you have to keep it what? As it is. You don't say Alhamdulillahi, Alhamdulillahi, which is a common mistake. People, they don't give any importance to the tashdidat. Especially if you are in a rush and you're reciting the Fatiha in a rush, you may fall into this by missing out the tashdidat. وإخراج الضاد. Likewise, the letter ضاد should be coming from the correct makhraj. It must come from the correct makhraj. طيب, and we know what the makhraj of the ضاد is, right? What did Ibn al-Jazari rahimahullah ta'ala he say? He said, وَالْوَسْطُ فَجِيمُ الشِّينُ يَا وَالْضَادُ مِنْ حَافَتِهِ إِذْ وَلِيَا لَضْرَاسَ مِنْ أَيْسَرَ أَوْ يُمْنَاهَا وَاللَّامُ أَدْنَاهَا لِمُنْتَهَاهَا. طيب, we've studied this before. And so you have to ensure that the makhraj of this letter comes from its right place. And the reason why is because many people, they fall into a mistake. They either turn the ضاد into a dal, or they turn it into a ضاء, or they turn it maybe even into a طاء. طيب, and so these are all mistakes. طيب, and they might change the word in terms of its wording and in terms of its meaning as well. طيب, so you have to ensure that you get the makhraj of the ضاد right. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وتجب في كل ركعة لا ركعة المسبوق. That the qira'ah of Surah Al-Fatiha is obligatory whether you are an imam, whether you are a ma'mum, it doesn't matter. There is no differentiation between the imam, the ma'mum, and the one who's praying by himself, which you call the munfarid, in the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha. All have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha in every single rak'ah. So if it's a 4-unit prayer, you need to read 4 Fatiha. If you are in a 3-unit prayer, it must be a 3 Fatiha. Whether you are an imam or a ma'mum or a munfarid. The only exception is the one who has come in a rak'ah where the imam is in the ruku'. And so the imam is already in the ruku' position and you've come into the masjid, then you just enter by saying takbirat ihram and then you join the imam. You don't recite Surah Al-Fatiha. فَيَسْقُطُ عَنْكَ فِي ذَلِكَ اللحظة. In that state, in this state, you are forgiven from the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha. That is the only scenario where a person doesn't have to come with the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, الخامس الركوع. And of course, the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha is put under the category of Arkan Al-Qawliyah. Now we move on to الركوع. الركوع is the bowing. And you have to come with this, and it's an integral act of the prayer. Allah said, وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. Right? وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. I.e. pray with those who are praying. So the ruku' is one of the essential parts of the prayer, such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word ruku' to mean salah. طيب. And so we have to come with this pillar. We have to perform it correctly and the way it should be done. And so you have to come with the ruku'. And the author rahimahullah mentioned that you have to perform the ruku' by al-tuma'ninatu fi. So we know how to perform the ruku', but we have to ensure that we are standing still, or we are in a still position. We come to rest in the ruku' position. بحيث يستقر كل عضو مكانه. Every single limb must come to rest in the ruku' position before you can exit from the ruku' position. طيب. And the ruku', as we said, it's a pillar, but هو ركن فعلي. It's a ركن that falls under the category of actions. Then the author رحمه الله mentioned الاعتدال. The next pillar is الاعتدال. And of course, السادس here, الطمأنينة فيه. We will put all of the other طمأنينة that come afterwards, we'll put it under this one. And so by that, we can get a total of 13 instead of a total of 17. The next pillar is al-i'tidal. When a person finishes the ruku', they don't go straight into sujood. Rather, they come out from the ruku' and they again stand up upright. Again, they stand what? Upright. And the author, rahimahullah, mentioned, وَالطُمَأْنِينَةُ فِيهِ. You have to also be upright and come to a still position. Come to rest in that position of standing upright. So you don't just يعني, come up halfway and then go into a sujood tarawih. لا. You have to, your whole body has to come up and stand straight and remain at rest in that position before you then transfer into the sujood position. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَالسُّجُودُ مَرَّتَيْن, two sujood, في كل ركعة. For every single ركعة, you have to perform two sujood. وَأَقَلُّهُ, the minimum requirement for the sujood is وَضُعُ شَيْءٍ مِّن جَبْهَتِهِ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ. As long as a part of your forehead touches the ground, i.e. a part of your forehead, not anything covering your forehead. مثلا, some people, they fall into a mistake of having an imama on or having a hat on, and that hat covers their entire forehead. And so when they go into sujood, it's not their head touching the ground, rather it's the imama or the head or the turban or the kofi that's touching the ground. No, you have to ensure that a part of the jabha touches the ground. And the best way to perform the sujood is to ensure that the seven organs that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Umirtu an asjuda ala sab'ati a'hud," that you have been commanded to prostrate upon seven limbs, that you ensure that these seven limbs touch the ground. And that is your jabha, including the nose, likewise your two hands, likewise your two knees, and likewise your two sets of toes. So ensure that all of these seven limbs or parts of your body touch the ground in the sujood. And the author rahimahullah hints at that by saying, وَوَضْعُ شَيْءٍ مِّن جَبْهَتِهِ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ وَوَضْعُ بَاطِنِ أَصَابِعِ يَدَيْهِ وَرِجْلَيْهِ وَوَضْعُ رُكْبَتِهِ وَتَحَامُلٌ بِرَأْسِهِ. That you have to ensure that your fingers are firm on the ground. Likewise, the toes are also on the ground. Likewise, your knees are on the ground, i.e. touching the ground, right? In contact with the ground. And likewise, when you go into the sujood, you have to ensure that you put enough force on your head so that if, مثلا, let's say if I was to put a piece of cotton on the ground and you were to make sujood on that cotton will become flattened, or it will change its shape. There will be a change in the shape of that cotton when I put my head on the ground, such as the force that I apply onto it. So there must be an element of force attached onto the, or applied onto the head, onto the ground. طيب. If there is no force, then this is not considered a sujood. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَارْتِفَاعُ أَسَافِلِهِ عَلَى أَعَالِهِ. Likewise, when you're performing the sujood, the back part of your body should be raised up and the head should be lowered down. And so if I was to, مثلاً, roll a ball from the top of your, whilst you're performing sujood, if I was to roll a ball, the ball will go downwards. It will be slanting downwards. It will travel downwards, not in a straight way. People like to perform sujood in a way where their backside is equivalent to their head, like they're lying down or something, or they're about to lie down or something. La. You have to perform the sujood where the back part of your body is raised up and your head is on the ground, and it's the lowest part of your body on the ground. طيب. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَالطُمَئِنَّةُ فِي. You have to remain still in and come to rest in that position. And the way in which you come to rest is by actually applying force. If you're applying force with your head onto the ground, then you're of course going to come to rest. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, Then he said, الْجُلُوسُ بَيْنَ السَّجْدَتَيْنِ. Likewise, between each sujood, there has to be a sit. There has to be a sit. So you don't just perform the two sujood consecutively back to back. لا. You come out of the first sajda, you sit. And you have الطُمَئِنَةُ فِي. You become rest at that position. Then you go back into the second sajda. And you perform the same thing as you've done in the first sajda. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَتَشَهُدُ الْأَخِيرِ. Likewise, the final tashahud is a pillar from the pillars of the salah. And al-qu'udu fi, when he says at-tashahud al-akhir, he means by the utterance. And when we say at-tashahud al-akhir, that falls under al-qawl, al-arkan al-qawliyya. As for the sujood and al-julusu bayna sajdatin, we put it under al-arkan al-fi'liyya. As for at-tashahud al-akhir, fawa ruknun qawli. And that is to say, at-tahiyyatu lillah, wa-salawatu wa-tayyibat, as-salamu alayka ayuhal nabi, wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, as-salamu alayna wa ala ibadillahi s-salihin, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. This is also a pillar from the pillars of the salah. Wal-qu'udu fi, when you are in the final tashahud, you have to sit down for it. You have to sit down for it. And so this qu'ud is min arkan al-fi'liyya. As for the qira'ati tashahud al-akhir, fawm min arkan الفعلية. Then the author rahimahullah, he said, والصلاة على النبي في أي في التشهد الأخير. After you recite the last تشهد, after you recite the التحيات, you then follow it up with اللهم صل على محمد, also known as الصلاة الإبراهيمية. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. And so I have to follow it up with that salat على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then after that, from the sunan, as we will see later إن شاء الله تعالى, is a dua, to make any form of dua that you wish. كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, used to seek refuge in Allah from four. كان يتعوذ بالله من أربع. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من عذاب جهنم ومن عذاب القبر ومن فتنة المحيا والمات ومن شر فتنة المسيح الدجال. طيب. And so this is what you have to come with. And then the last or the second to last pillar is السلام أو التسليم. And this is again a ركن قولي that you say السلام عليكم وأقله السلام عليكم. And you can also say السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. You can also say السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And the first تسليم is the pillar. As for the second تسليم, then it is what? A sunnah. طيب. And that falls under the هيئات. However, the first one is considered the pillar. And so if you come with the first taslima, then alhamdulillah, you have finished your salah. And this is the definition of the salah, right? أقوال مخصوصة أفعال مخصوصة تفتتح بالتكبير وتختتم بالتسليم عادة. And as for the final pillar, and this is one of the most important pillars, which is الترتيب. You have to pray in that sequential order. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي. Pray as you see me pray. And he prayed in that order. He prayed in the order that we mentioned. And so these are the pillars of the prayer, the integral acts of the prayer that a person must come with in order to preserve the validity of the salah. طيب, these are what we call arkan al-salah and furud al-salah. Then the author رحمه ta'ala goes on to speak about sunan al-salah, the sunan of the salah, which we said divides into two, which are hay'at and ab'av. Ab'av are sunan mu'akkada, hay'at are sunan ghayr mu'akkada. Mu'akkada means if you miss a hay'a, then you have to cover it up with sujood as-sahw. But if you miss if you miss an ab'av, you have to come with sujood as-sahw. But if you miss a hay'a, then you don't have to come with sujood as-sahw. طيب, the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَسُنَنُهَا كَثِيرَةً رَفْعُ الْيَدَيْنِ عِنْ تَكْبِيرَةِ الْإِحْرَامِ وَعِنْدَ الرُّكُوعِ وَعِنْدَ الرَّفْعِ مِنْ وَعِنْدَ الْقِيَامِ مِنَ التَّشَهُّدِ الْأَوَّلِ. So from the sunan is رَفْعُ الْيَدَيْنِ, to raise the hands. عِنْدَ الْمَذْهَبِ وَهَذَا هُوَ الصَّحِيحُ, is that you raise the hands when performing takbirat al-ihram. Likewise, when going into ruku', likewise, when coming out of ruku', and likewise, when coming up from the first tashahud and to in a three unit or a four unit prayer. طيب, these are sunan. Likewise, ومن سننها دعاء الاستفتاح. When you say Allahu Akbar, as has come in the hadith, that a messenger of Allah wouldn't go straight into the recitation of the Fatiha. Rather, he would remain silent for a bit. And the Sahaba would see his beard moving. And so they asked the Messenger of Allah, why is your beard moving? What do you say during the period of silence between the Takbirat al-Ihram and the Qira'at of the Fatiha? And so the Messenger of Allah gave them a dua, which we call dua al-istiftah, which is to say, Allahumma ba'id bayni wa bayna khatayaya kama ba'adta bayna al-mashriq wal-maghrib. Allahumma naqqini min khatayaya kama yunaqqa thawb al-abyad min al-danas. Allahumma ghsilni min khatayaya bil-ma'i wal-thalji. والبرد. Another form of dua, سبحانك اللهم بحمدك وتبارك اسمك وتعالى جدك ولا إله غيرك وقد ورد. There are many forms of this dua that a person can make. والأمر فيها ساعة. Then the author رحمه الله, he said, ثم التعوذ. Then you come with the تعوذ, الاستعاذة. And the استعاذة is always what? سرا, in secret. You say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Then you recite البسملة in out loud. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين. طيب. وقراءة سورة لغير المأموم السامع قراءة إمامه بعد الفاتحة. Likewise, reciting a surah after the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha is also a sunnah. And so when you finish Surah Al-Fatiha, you are recommended to recite another surah. And of course, this is only for the غير المأموم. This is for all individuals except for المأموم السامع قراءة إمامه. This is a recommendation for everybody except for the one who is praying behind an imam and he can hear the recitation of the imam. And so if you are praying behind an imam and you can hear the imam reciting the Quran, then you are commanded to listen to the Quran and not recite yourself. Rather, and this is of course in accordance to the command of Allah Azza wa Jal, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. And so when the imam recites Surah Al-Fatiha and he says Ameen, you should now as the ma'moom recite your Fatiha. Recite your Fatiha. And as soon as you finish your Fatiha, you then listen to what the Imam is reciting. And this is why the A'imma rahimahumullah, may Allah preserve our A'imma and those who lead us in the salawat, they should try to sometimes give some form of time so that the ma'mum can recite the Fatiha. So that the ma'mum can recite the Fatiha, and then he's able to listen to the recitation of the Quran. However, if you are not somebody who can hear the recitation of the Quran, so you're still a ma'mum, but you can't hear the Quran being recited. You can't hear the Quran being recited. In this case, you are recommended to also recite any surah after surah al-Fatiha. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, وَالْجَهْرُ فِي الصُّبْحِ وَفِي الرَّكْعَتَيْنِ الْأُولَيَيْنِ مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ وَالْعِشَاءِ مِنَ الرَّجُلِ وَالْمَرْأَةِ إِلَّمْ يَحْضُرْ عِنْدَهَا رِجَالٌ أَجَانِبٌ. Likewise, reciting out loud in Salat al-Fajr, both units. Likewise, the first two units of Maghrib and Isha is something which is recommended and highly recommended. The Prophet ﷺ used to do it. طيب. And this is for men. As for women, if they are alone, then there is no problem. Or if they are with the Maharim, there is no problem. But if they are with Ajanib, then they should lower their voice and they shouldn't perform Al-Jahr. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, وَوَضْعُ الْيُمْنَى عَلَى كَوْعِ الْيُسْرَى تَحْتَ صَدْرِهِ. Likewise, putting the inner palm of your right hand over the outer palm of your left hand underneath the chest. تَحْتَ صَدْرِهِ. And of course, there is sa'a in this. It could either be on the navel or just above the navel on the chest. طيب. And as for putting it at the top like this, that's something which we shouldn't do. Should avoid that. However, putting it on your chest or just below your chest or even slightly below the chest towards the navel, there is no problem in that. الأمر فيها واسع إن شاء الله. والتكبيرات غير تكبيرات إحرام. Likewise, as you mentioned previously, all other takbirat outside takbirat al-ihram is something which is sunnah. But takbirat al-ihram is a rukn. The author, rahimahullah, he said, والقنوت في الاعتدال أو في اعتدال الثانية من الصبح. And this is a min abad al-salah, according to the Shafi'iyya, that you recite some form of qunut, dua al-qunut, after you come up from the ruku' of the second rak'ah in Salat al-Fajr. And if you go to the lands of the Shafi'iyya today, like Malaysia and so on, you find that this is a sunnah which is still practiced today. طيب, they recite the dua al-qunut ba'da, aw ba'da al-i'tidali al-thaniyati min Salat al-Fajr. After they come up from the ruku' during the second rak'ah, or at the end of the second rak'ah, أو صلاة الفجر, they come with القنوت, دعاء القنوت, and this is a daily thing. وهذا هو مذهب الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى. This is the view and the مذهب of the Imam الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى. كان يرى القنوت بعد الفجر, and he used to see the قنوت when بعد الاعتدال الثانية من صلاة الفجر, as opposed to المالكية who say what, that you should perform the قنوت at the end of the qira'ah after the second rak'ah. So in the second rak'ah, when you finish the recitation of the Quran, you then should come with the qunut. That's according to the madhab of Imam Malik rahimahullahu ta'ala. As for the madhab of Shafi'i, then it is after you come out from the ruku' of the second rak'ah, when you stand up, when you say sami'allah min hamd rabbana wa lakal hamd, you then make the du'a al-qunut. Allahumma hadina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa barik lana fi ma atayt, wa qina sharra ma qadayt, fa innaka taqdi wa la yuqda 'alayk, and so on. طيب. وفي سائر المكتوبات للنازلة. Likewise, if there is a specific incident that took place, for example, some of the Muslimin were treated in a bad way with oppression, they were oppressed, طيب, or some form of evil took place, some form of harm afflicted us, then you are also permitted to perform dua al-qunut after the or at the last rak'ah of every single salah when you come out from the ruku' for the last rak'ah of every single salah. That's also permissible. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did this after the companions, or after some of his companions, 70 odd of his companions were slaughtered unjustly fi bi'ri ma'una. Fi bi'ri ma'una. طيب. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَيَقُولُ فِي الرُّكُوعِ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَنَ عَظِيمُ بِحَمْدِهِ ثَلَاثًا. Now he goes on to mentioning the sunnah pertaining to what you should say. And so when you are in the ruku' you should say سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَنَ عَظِيمُ بِحَمْدِهِ three times. That's the sunnah. وفي السجود سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده ثلاثة. When you're in the sujood, you should say سبحان ربي الأعلى وبحمده three times. ويضع في السجود ركبتيه ثم يديه ثم جبهته وأنفه. Now he goes on to speaking about what a person should do, or how a person should go into the sujood. You are standing upright. You are now trying to go into sujood. How should you go into sujood? The way in which you go into sujood is by first going down on your knees. So you first go down on your knees. then you go down on your hands, then you go down on your forehead, and then your nose touches the ground last. And so it's knees, then hands, then head, then nose. That is how you go down from the upright position into the sujood position عند المذهب. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, ويقول بين السجدتين رب اغفر لي وارحمني واجبرني وارفعني وارزقني واهدني وعافني واعف عني. Then you say a form of dhikr, and this form of dhikr, which can also be shortened to رب اغفر لي وارحمني وارزقني واهدني وعافني واعف عني واجبرني وارفعني. These are also extensions that a person can make. طيب, these are adhkar that a person can make whilst sitting between the two sujood. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَتُسَنُّ جَلْسَةُ الْإِسْتِرَاحَةِ فِي الْأُولَى وَالثَّالِثَةِ مِنْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْرِبِ. Likewise, when a person wants to get up from the first rak'ah to the second rak'ah, or he wants to get up from a third rak'ah to a fourth rak'ah, i.e. from the sujood position into the fourth rak'ah, or from the sujood position into the second rak'ah, then if it's not a maghrib salah, he is allowed to want to take a little bit of rest. So like 1 second, 2 second rest before he actually stands up into the second rak'ah. That's also a sunnah. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَيُسَنُّ تَشَهُدُ الْأَوَّلِ وَالْقُعُودُ لَهُ وَالصَّلَاةُ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فِيهِ وَفِي الْقُنُودِ. Likewise, there is a sunnah for a person to want to sit in the first tashahud and to say the first tashahud, التحيات لله والصلوات والطيبات السلام عليك أيها النبي ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام علينا وعلى عباد الله الصالحين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. This is also a sunnah, تشهد الأول. And of course, تشهد الأول is only existing for the salawat that are more than 2 units. So if you have a 3-unit prayer, a 4-unit prayer, and these, of course, the salawat can only be either 2 units, which is the Fajr, 3 units, which is Maghrib, and the remaining salawat, which is Asr, Dhuhr, and Isha, they are 4-unit prayers. And so during these units, a 3-unit prayer and a 4-unit prayer, you have a first tashahud. And this first tashahud is a sunnah, وهو من الأبعاد. It is from the أبعاد الصلاة. And so if you miss the first tashahud, you should cover it up with sujood as-sahw. Likewise, sending salutations and salat upon the Prophet is something which is highly recommended for a person to do whilst in the first tashahud. In the second tashahud, it's a rukun, it's a pillar. But in the first tashahud, it's a sunnah. وَهُوَ مِنْ أَبْعَاضِ الصَّلَاةِ أَيْضًا. طيب, that you say, اللهم صل على محمد الصلاة إبراهيمية المشهورة. Likewise, in the qunut, you should end with the sending salawat upon the Prophet. This, of course, the general principle when it comes to dua. You begin with Alhamdulillah, you begin by praising Allah, then sending salutations upon the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then making whatever dua you want to wish, then ending with As-salat ala al-Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَالْإِفْتِرَاشُ فِي جَمِيعِ الْجَلَسَاتِ وَالتَّوَرُّكُ فِي التَّشَهُدِ الْأَخِيرِ. Any sitting that you perform during the salah outside of the last sitting, which is of course going to be for التَّشَهُدِ الْأَخِيرِ, you should sit in a position known as Al-Iftirash, which is where you sit on your left foot, you sit on it, and your left foot is lying flat on the ground, and you put up your right foot, as we commonly see today, like this. You see? طيب. And so, and I'll put a picture up, inshallah ta'ala, as it's an audio, I'll put the picture up so that you can see the difference between al-iftirash and the difference between al-tawarruk. It's quite difficult to explain it linguistically or via yani language, طيب, because it's best to see it in application, and many of us know the difference between al-iftirash and al-tawarruk. طيب, al-tawarruk is to put your left foot underneath your right foot and you sit on, and your bum touches the ground, as opposed to the iftirash, where your bum sits on the left foot and your right foot is put upwards. طيب, and your toes are touching the ground and the rest of your foot is raised up. طيب, that is al-iftirash, and that's for all forms of sitting outside of the final sit, which is going to be at-tashahud al-akhir. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَيُسَنُّ فِيهَا النَّظَرُ إِلَى مَوْضِعِ السُّجُودِ. When you're praying and you are reading your Quran and you're reciting the Fatiha and so on, and you are standing, you should look at the place where you're going to make sujood. That is the correct way of doing it. And of course, some of the madahib are of the opinion that you can look forward as well. And if you're in the Kaaba, مثلاً, some ulama, rahimahullah, of your view, that you can what? You can look at the Kaaba directly. But outside of that, then you should be looking at the mawdi' as-sujood. You shouldn't be looking around, looking upwards and so on. لا. You should be looking towards the mawdi' as-sujood, and that is easier and more helpful in garnering and gaining khushu', which is the whole purpose of the salah. Ista'inu bis-sabr was-salah wa innaha lakabiratun illa 'ala al-khashi'in. So if you want to gain khushu', then the goal of gaining khushu', or the whole purpose of the salah, is to gain khushu'. That's the reason why we are praying al-khushu'. And so one of the ways that you can that can assist you in gaining khushu' is by focusing your attention on the place where you're going to be prostrating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned the concept of al-khushu' right afterwards, because as I said, it's one of the best ways to assist and help you in what? In focusing on your prayer and coming with the required khushu'. وَالتَّدَبُّرْ فِي الْقِرَاءَةِ. Likewise, when you're reciting the Qur'an, make sure that you are contemplating over the recitation of the Qur'an. The Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said regarding it, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّهُ آيَاتِهِ. The reason why this Qur'an has been revealed to us is so that we can contemplate over its verses, so that we can contemplate over the recitation. When we hear the Qur'an being recited, we contemplate over it. فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا. فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ. And so a way of gaining mercy is by listening to the Quran and contemplating over the meanings that we find in the Quran al-Kareem that we are listening to. وتطويل الركعة الأولى على الثانية. Likewise, a sunnah is that you make the first rak'ah longer than the second rak'ah. And so you recite the first rak'ah longer than the second rak'ah. So if you recite it in the first rak'ah, مثلاً بسورة عبس, then the second rak'ah should be a surah shorter than that. For example, surah al-Shams or surah al-A'la or something like that. طيب. وَدُخُولُهَا بِنَشَاطٍ وَفَرَاغِ قَلْبٍ. Likewise, when you enter into the salah, you have to leave off the dunya. Your heart should be completely free from anything pertaining to the dunya. You should completely focus your attention upon the salah. And you should come to the salah with what? With nashat, with enthusiasm. Because the sign of the munafiq is what? وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالًا. وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالًا. They stand up for the prayer lazily. So we don't stand up for the prayer lazily. Rather, we stand up to the prayer with enthusiasm, that we are going to have a communication with our Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَكَثْرَةُ الدُّعَاءِ فِي السُّجُودِ. Likewise, when you're in a state of sujood, make sure you make as much dua as possible. Because the closest place where a person finds himself to his Lord Jalla Jalaluhu, وَهُوَ سَاجِدْ. أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدْ. And so, أَكْثِرُوا مِنَ الدُّعَاءِ. And so, make sure that you make as much dua as possible whilst in the state of السجود. Then the author رحمه الله تعالى, he said, فصل. وتبطل الصلاة بالكلام الكثير والأكل الكثير وبالفعل الكثير كثلاث خطوات أو ثلاث ضربات متواليات. So now he's going to speak about those things that break a person's salah. And so just as we ensure we come with the integral act and we try to come with as much sunan as possible, we have to also stay away from the multilat. We have to stay away from those matters that nullify our prayer, that render our prayer null and void, that invalidate our prayer. Number one is al-kalam al-kathir. If you speak a lot, and of course al-kalam al-kathir, kalam here according to the fuqaha, it means what? Kalimatun aw harfun mufhim aw harfani ghayr mufhim. If you speak one letter that is understandable, like qi mathalan aw ki mathalan, which are af'al amr, which are command verbs, طيب. If you mention that in the salah, طيب, عمدًا, on purpose, then your salah is باطلة. Your salah is invalid. Likewise, if you speak حرفان أو ثلاثة أحرف أو أربع أحرف أو كلمة أو كلمتان كلمة ثلاث كلمات غير مفهمة, and you do this on purpose, then your salah is what? باطلة. What if a person speaks out of forgetfulness, تكلم ساهيا, then we see, is the كلام a lot or is it a little? And we mentioned that a lot is generally six words or more, according to some ulama like Ibn Hajar al-Haytami rahimahullah ta'ala. But if it's less than that, then it's forgiven. It is forgiven. Likewise, same thing when it comes to eating. If a person eats a lot, for example, is eating a whole bag of Haribo, he's methadan eating, or drinking a whole bucket of water or a whole bottle of water, then this person's salah is, of course, nullified. It's la salat ala, this person has no salah. But if, let's say, somebody by accident, something, he had maybe some food stuck in his mouth, مثلا, and by accident it came out and he swallowed it, for example, then there is no problem in that. يعفى عنه, that is forgiven. Likewise, الفعل الكثير, when a person performs a lot of actions, a lot of movement, like three consecutive movements, he moves forward three times and he's doing it on purpose, مثلا, then his salah becomes باطلة. And likewise, if a person is doing consecutive movements such that when I look at him, عرفا, in terms of customary, I look at this person and I see him, this guy is not performing salah. He's jumping around, he's doing this, he's doing that, he's looking around. This guy, when you look at him, he's not praying. It doesn't seem like he's praying. But if somebody مثلا scratched his head or something whilst in the salah, there is no problem in that. There is no problem in that. What we deem al-fi'l, the fi'l that is deemed to be nullified or can nullify a person's prayer, is al-fi'l al-kathir. الفعل الكثير الذي يوهم من يراك, the one who, when he sees you praying, he thinks you are not praying. You might see yourself praying, but actually when the person sees you, you're not praying because of the actions that a person comes with during the salah. It is not an action that somebody should come with who is actually performing the salah the way that it should be performed. And the author, rahimahullah, gave examples, كثلاث خطوات أو ثلاث ضربات متغيرة. Somebody who's hitting things consecutive times, or مثلا he's moving forward and backward in a consecutive motion, طيب, or his tip, مثلا he's jumping up and down, مثلا, you find people who fall into this whilst in their salah, طيب, and so you have to what, avoid all of that. You have to avoid الكلام الكثير, والفعل الكثير, والأكل الكثير. In fact, you should avoid it in totality, because this is just 5 minutes of your time you are giving to Allah Azza wa Jal in order to perform this act of worship. And so perfect it. And as we know, the salat is going to be what? The first thing that we are going to be asked about on the Day of Judgment. And so we have to try our best to avoid these things. Even if we say that some of these acts may not be considered nullified in a prayer, like we mentioned, al-kalamul qaleel, if done sahiyan, you have to try and avoid it as much as possible. Like, even if you understand those rulings, still avoid it. Because يعني, nobody knows whether their salah is going to be accepted or not. A person might perform a salah and he's not being rewarded except for a ninth of it, or an eighth of it, or a seventh of it, and so on. كما جاء في حديث عمار ابن ياسر رضي الله تعالى عنه. Then the author, رحمه الله تعالى, he said, والضربة المفرطة والوثبة الفاحشة. Likewise, jumping up and down or hitting somebody whilst in the salah on purpose. طيب, then this is something which is going to what? Nullify a person's prayer. And the only exception that is given is a person who walks by you or walks in front of you, and there is and he's trying to walk in between you and your sutra. Remember, the sunnah is that you have a sutra in front of you always, right? A form of spear or a barrier, a preventer between you and somebody walking by. Right? For example, if it's a wall, or if it's a mushaf, like a mushaf stander, a mushaf holder or something, right? Which is the common you find in many masajid, that is the common form of sutra that is used today, or مثلا a your bag, مثلا, any form of thing that can be considered a sutra, طيب, you put that in front of you. If a person now tries to walk between you and that sutra, you are permitted to stop him. You are permitted to stop him, and if he doesn't desist, then you are permitted to fight him, and that doesn't nullify your prayer. طيب, then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَإِن تَكَلَّمْ بِكَلَامٍ قَلِيلٍ نَاسِيًا أَوْ أَكَلَ قَلِيلًا نَاسِيًا أَوْ زَادَ رُكُوعًا أَوْ سُجُودًا نَاسِيًا لَمْ تَبْطُلْ وَيَسْجُدُ لِلسَّهْوِ. And this is what I mentioned previously. If a person speaks قَلِيلًا, and the قَلِيل, we mentioned it to be less than 6 words, كَمَا قَالَ ابن حَجَرَ الْهَيْتِمِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ, or he eats some small amount of food نَاسِيًا, forgetfulness or involuntarily, or he adds a ruku' or he adds a sujood onto the salah by way of forgetfulness, of course, the asr is that if you add onto the salah on purpose, or if you take away from the salah on purpose, that salah is invalid. That salah is invalid. But if you add onto the sujood, or sorry, if you add onto the salah nasiyan, out of forgetfulness, مثلا, you add onto the salah a rak'ah nasiyan, or you add onto the salah a sujood out of a mistake, or you add onto the salah a ruku' out of a mistake, and this occurred to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam multiple times, فلا تبطل الصلاة. The salah does not become nullified, rather you carry on with the salah and you cover up that mistake with what? With sujood as-sahw, which we will speak about in more detail in the next lesson. We'll stop here bi-ithnillah. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.